chemistry at ITBHU. He is a physical chemist trained in laser spectroscopy, Raman's microscopy, and computational chemistry. After his PhD from IIT Kanpur, he has had postdoctoral experience in South Korea, Switzerland, and Germany. His current research is focused on surface-enhanced Raman scattering and applying Raman imaging in biology and medicine. His other academic interests include the history of science in ancient, medieval India, and theoretical aspects of the classical music. So he is also the Fulbright Scholar and served as a member of National Core Committee of INEAS, a body of INSA. So with this brief introduction, I welcome you, sir, for your talk. Yes, over to you, sir.
Ms. Anupama, for that kind introduction. And I also place on record my hearty gratitude to Dr. Pooja for having given me the opportunity to present a little bit of what I know from a part of my research that we do in our group. And the moment she offered, I quickly grabbed it, because during this lockdown situation and pandemic situation, reaching out to people through such e-medium is indeed a wonderful thing, but it has its own technical glitches, as you observed, as I was late by, you know, because of some problem from my end. So I thank once again the organizers for having given me this opportunity, and also thank to have accommodated me today, because I was initially slated for tomorrow. That's again because of my absent-mindedness that I had agreed to two different people at the same time. So thank you for accommodating me at the last moment after I have requested. I would like to share the presentation. Let me open up. Yeah, I hope you're able to see the PowerPoint.
So it's still appearing on the screen.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's on the screen now. Yes, sir.
So as it's titled, it's an introduction. I'll try to cover the basics and how we do it in our lab and how it has been done in the literature also. So, but before I begin on the surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy, as Dr. Poo, we are indeed the proud what we call countrymen or contemporary of the Nobel Prize, which the one and only Nobel Prize in science awarded to the work done by C.V. Raman on this soil of this country. There have been other Indian scientists who have been awarded Nobel Prize, but those are for the work done elsewhere. So to date, this stands the only work that was awarded in 1930. So it's almost 100 years. I mean, right now it is 90 years back. So this is to do with Raman effect, which is in fact the nonlinear scattering of the light photons after interacting with the molecules or scattering medium. So just to give a historical background, it was the nonlinear or the nonlinear scattering that the X-rays, X-ray photon, whatever effect was observed, the X-rays, that in fact had got the Nobel Prize somewhere in 1925. By that time, even from 1921 onwards, Raman had focused his study towards the optical scattering using different scattering media. Now, when this effect Prize in 1925, Raman got seriously involved into it, and his entire focus was directed towards it. And lo and behold, you know that it is 1928. He announced it to the world, and in 1930 he got the Nobel Prize. And to this day we celebrate February 28. Every day, every year we celebrate that as our National Science Day in memory of the Raman effect that he had announced on February 28, 1928. February, yeah. So that's the history part. Very basics of the scattering, like the light is incident on any medium, we can divide the process into three that normally happens to the photon. It either gets reflected, part of it gets absorbed, and part of it gets transmitted, and part of it gets scattered. Okay? And in the scattering also, there are two types, one that is elastic and one that is inelastic, and it is the inelastic one which constitutes the Raman effect. In a very semi-classical way, you can understand Raman in semi-classical way as well as in quantum mechanical way. A semi-classical way is in when the matter is treated in a classical way, and the photon is treated. So the photon is treated in a different way. Whereas in quantum mechanical way, both the matter as well as the incoming photon are treated in a quantum mechanical way. So here, what I'm presenting to you is a semi-classical approach, where the bond can be looked upon as a spring, a mass. The atoms of the molecule can be looked upon as mass attached to springs, and the springs standing for the chemical bond. And since you are vibrating, the Hooke's law is applicable. And since it's only a two-body system, the Hooke's law is very simplified here. And that's what you see it as mu d square q by dt square, where q is a generalized coordinate here. And this is your mass, this is your matter. Force is equal to minus kx, that's from the Hooke's law. And this is the way we present the incoming electromagnetic radiation, which has an amplitude, say, q. And it is having the frequency of nu m. And you can see that the q is used same here, Hooke's law as well as in this radiation. Why? Because this is the incoming radiation which is going to the medium. And Raman activity can be gauged through the polarizability of the molecule. So the polarizability can be written as alpha E naught cos 2 pi nu t, where alpha is given as alpha naught plus q dou alpha by dou t plus 1 and so forth. So if we substitute from the previous expression, we get this. I mean, ultimately, what we get is a term. This is the expression. I mean, you can call it as the induced polarizability of the medium, and that is also going to be the expression for the outgoing electromagnetic radiation after the radiation has interacted with this polarized medium. So consequently, your attention has to be drawn to this term here. What incoming radiation had is nu m frequency. Now outgoing, we have two additional frequencies in that is nu naught minus nu m and nu naught plus nu m. Okay, nu naught is the original frequency with which the radiation had come. And what you have is now an outgoing frequency with radiations plus nu m plus nu m. So these two are what are referred to as the Stokes and the anti-Stokes shift with respect to the incoming radiation. And together, this is what is referred to as a Raman scattering, where the energy of the photon is changing with compared to the incoming photon. And the extent of change is what is translating or what is carrying the vibrational information of the molecule. This nu m carries the information about the, mathematically also you can see it talks about the extent of polarization, which has got to do with the nature of the bond over there. In other words, the Stokes and the anti-Stokes shift, they directly relate to the vibration of the molecules in the system that we are investigating using Raman spectroscopy. So same thing in a very cartoon way of depiction, animated way of depiction, I'm trying to show it here. The blue ball is like your photon, incoming photon. And this is like a vibrating molecule, vibrating represented by a membrane. So when this ball interacts with this membrane, you could anticipate you can divide this interaction into three different steps. One where the ball does not exchange energy with the membrane. That is when the membrane is in the equilibrium position, the ball comes and interacts, so there is absolutely no change. the energy is in either the membrane or the ball. But if the ball is interacting with the membrane, when the membrane is, say, stretched up, it can get the energy from the membrane, whereby lose the energy by within by itself. And when the membrane is having a lower energy mode, say, then the photon can give energy to the membrane. And as a result, when it comes out, it can come out with a lesser energy. So these are the Rayleigh shift, the Rayleigh scattering, and the Stokes and the anti-Stokes that I try to describe using this simple animation. And the same thing in an energy level way, energy diagram way, in other words, in a quantum mechanical way, in the picture presentation, the Raman effect is in this way. All these horizontal black lines are your, say, electronic vibrational states within an electronic state. And the blue arrows are your incident radiation. They will bring about the excitation. You can see the red arrow, there is no change in the length of the arrows, of blue and red, which means there is no change in the energy because y-axis here is the energy. So this is a typically Rayleigh scattering, where no exchange of energy happens or plastic collision. Whereas the smaller in length, or in other words, lesser in energy, and that's a shift. And the purple arrow is longer in length, or indicating higher energy, which is representing the anti-Stokes shift. In this case, as you all might be already knowing, that ambient condition, say at normal temperatures, everything, most of our, all the molecules that we deal with, the population is governed by a Boltzmann distribution. You know, the population decreases or increases exponentially. Population decreases exponentially as the energy is decreasing. The population is at the ground state, and as you increase, the population actually exponentially decreases. So, in principle, when we observe the Raman spectrum, the Stokes shift will have larger intensity compared to the anti-Stokes shift at normal conditions. Why? Because lower state are more populated, and as the population, as the energy state increases, the population decreases. If the population is decreasing, the anti-Stokes scattering cross-section of anti-Stokes Raman scattering intensity is also very, very low compared to Stokes Raman scattering. This again, I am repeating, it is at the ambient condition. But if you increase it, for instance, if you are recording, it's like, say, your candle flame or a fire flame. There, the opposite trend will happen, because in that high temperature condition of the flame, your population in it's excited states, excited vibrational states are also very much populated. So, hence, the anti-Stokes radiation, anti-Stokes scattering will become more intense. Between the green arrow and the blue arrow, or the purple arrow and the blue arrow, is what is going to give us a difference between the 0 and the 1 level, which is vibrational level. So that this Raman, the Stokes photon or that carry in itself the vibrational information. This is infrared spectroscopy and Raman spectroscopy give you the same information, rather similar information. But in the mode, the technique of these two experiments are very different. In the infrared, there is an absorption, net absorption happening. Whereas in the Raman, it is scattering. And hence, there are technical details which are very different, like the selection rules are different. Transitions, which transitions are allowed, those are also very different. But there is details on that. Saying that, although this Raman is a very effective way, no wonder it has got the Nobel Prize, yet it is a very weak phenomenon, so weak that it's only 1 in a million photon that undergo Raman scattering. So you, I mean, that also can be understood that even though Nobel Prize was given in 1930, it had to, I mean, for 30 years, there were not many publications. Not many were doing Raman spectroscopy, actually, for 30 long years, 3 decades. But if you look at the number of papers between 1930 and 1960, and if you compare the number of papers between 1960 and 1970, 30 years versus 10 years, that 10-year paper will be much, much more than the 30 years paper. And something very remarkable happened in that 1960 to 70 decade. And that was the invention of the lasers. With the laser, what had happened is this Raman technique got a thorough boost, and everybody started using lasers as an optical source for the conducting Raman spectroscopy. And that's why I say that that decade onwards, the number of papers coming out in Raman spectroscopy, there was an avalanche breakdown. I mean, it was like an avalanche effect. You had a lots and lots of number of papers, because now you have a very powerful source with which you can bring about the Raman scattering. Not just the laser, I mean, pretty soon when the laser were discovered, you had different avatars of Raman scattering also were turning out to be possible. One such avatar is your surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy, and that's what we are going to talk today. So SERS, it's about it is an enhancement of Raman scattering by the molecules, but several orders of magnitude, and it makes use of metallic nanoparticles. Originally, when it was discovered in the 1960s, they had just used roughened surface. Okay, about the history also, I will spend a few minutes. But then nowadays, ever since the nanotechnology has taken up in a very large way, surface enhanced Raman scattering is what is carried out using metal nanoparticles. So here the abbreviation you all know, S is for surface. It's a surface technique. E is for a signal enhancement, and that happens because of what are referred to as plasmons on the metal surface, and the incoming radiation brings about a plasmon resonance, and that plasmonic resonance gets coupled with the molecular vibration, and that is what is represented by the term R, because that carries the fingerprint or the vibrational information, and S is for scattering of spectroscopy. Now, this is what is pictorially again depicted. You have a substrate on which you have metal nanoparticles. Then you have the molecules getting adsorbed on them. When I say adsorbed, it could be physisorbed or it could be chemisorbed. And then you come with the incoming radiation or the incident light. And then you get the scattered, the Raman, you know, surface enhanced Raman scattered light. So it was not 60s, I'm rather sorry, it is 70s when Van Dwine actually first reported it. And independently, Van Dwine is credited for the kind of invention of the surface enhanced Raman scattering. It was observed by a person called Fleischmann, and it's a big controversy. Why are these people still not awarded the Nobel Prize? The first molecule which they had observed was pyridine. It was absorbed on an electrochemically roughened silver electrode, and they observed very unusual enhancement in the Raman intensity. And initially, they attributed to the increased surface area due to roughness of the substrate. Then it was the astute observation by Van Dwine and Crichton. Then they figured out that it is not just because of the increased surface area by the roughened silver substrate, because the numbers were not adding up or tallying. They said that the intensification or the enhancement is much, much more than what they would have expected by using the roughened surface. So then the theory was starting to build up for this, and in 1978 you get this theory proposed that it is because of this excitation of the surface plasmons on the metal surface that, and this surface this plasmon resonance getting coupled with the molecular vibration, that is really causing you the enhancement. So broadly there are two mechanisms attributed to the total enhancement. One is based on the electromagnetic resonance. It is based on the resonance excitation, as I just explained. And the other is, it's also feasible and possible, people have observed it. That's called the chemical or the molecular enhancement. And that happens because by increasing the polarizability of the molecule, because of the chemisorption, because of the chemical interaction between the analyte and the adsorbate. Average, there have been reports which have reported enhancement factor of even more than 10 to the power 6. Sometimes there have been reports of enhancement factor of 10 to the power 8. And with all novelties on the morphological modification of the substrate, the kind of research that Dr. Pooja does, the way you kind of engineer the morphology of the substrate, the enhancement will vary. And creativity, there is no limit to imagination here. There are reports where, you know, people have used gold cones, gold cylinders to trap the molecule, and even single electron spectroscopy have also been carried out using differently engineered nanomaterials. So the electromagnetic theory, the theory, the complete theory of SERS, people are still working out. So as I said, as the adsorbate morphology is continuously changing, as the techniques are continuously changing, the theory is still getting improvised. But fundamentally, what is assumed is this electromagnetic mechanism or the chemical molecular mechanism. So the electromagnetic mechanism, as I already mentioned, is because of the surface plasmon. The incoming electromagnetic field is exciting the surface plasmon of the nanomaterial. And this has a very specific name. It's called the dipolar localized surface plasmon resonance, the LSPR. And this collective oscillations of the conduction electrons against the surface plasmons are nothing but the collective oscillations of the conducting electrons against the background of the ionic metal cores. Then the resonance frequency, that is omega max of the plasmons in the metallic nanostructure, depends on the dielectric functions of the metal, epsilon of the metal, which is a function of the omega and the surrounding medium. So the LSPs is accompanied by a sharply enhanced amplitude of the electromagnetic field in the closest vicinity of the roughened metal surface. I mean, this area of research has gained much advancement in the recent years, where they use, you know, different kind of exotic nanostructures and look at how the electromagnetic radiation is getting trapped in those kind of local antennas. That branch of research is independently going, but in the SERS field, it suffices to say that even those materials can be used as SERS substrate, very good SERS substrate. So, yep. Because of this local trapment of this electromagnetic radiation, the molecule adsorbed on the surface is subjected to a much stronger electromagnetic wave, and that is what is your because of this plasmon, that is what you call it as E localized. And then you have this coupling, and then the enhancement there happens. The overall SERS intensity depends on both the incoming omega and the outgoing. Outgoing here is nothing but the vibrational frequency. So the overall SERS enhancement would depend on the frequency of the incoming radiation as well as the vibrational frequency. That's obvious. Why? Because it's the incoming radiation which is going to excite the plasmon, and this excited plasmon are getting into resonance, or they're getting coupled with the vibrational frequency. But it'll very much depend upon the vibrational frequency. This is also to tell you that not all vibrations will be getting uniformly excited. So if you take in a molecule, say, which has got a CC bond, which has got a CH bond, which has got a CO bond, each of them has got different polarizabilities. In other sense, that the delocalization of the electrons in each of these bonds, the extent to which they can get delocalized or polarized is very different because of the different electronegativities of the atoms which make up this bond. And hence, the plasmonic coupling to these kind of bonds will also be very, very different. and that will in turn determine the intensity of the SIRS peaks. Okay. Please let me know how much time I have, because as per the mail, I was supposed to speak for 40 minutes, and I see that it is 5:40 now, but
sir,
I may
no
take
problem.
10 more minutes.
Sir, no problem. You can take your time.
Because I had already come late and there were some hiccups. I will try
no
to
problem.
Find up. I'll
no
try to
problem.
Find up 15 more minutes. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So the requirement for this is that size and shape of the nanostructure, they ought to be between 30 and 100 nanometers. But this is not a very stringent condition. People have observed surface enhancement even by using larger substrate, larger nanomaterial, larger size of the substrate. But if you have it this size range, yes, it is very ideal. Enhancement factor will be much, much bigger. Now coming to this point of how the enhancement factor is actually determined. So, and it's not very straightforward also. There are different papers which adopt different strategies to come out with an enhancement factor. Two of them I'm going to describe. There are more than that also. I'll make a brief mention of others also in this. So if you look at a small metallic sphere with the radius R, which is smaller than 1/20th of the incident light's wavelength, then this enhancement factor is given here like this, where this is the amplitude in the sense of the incoming radiation. And I will not bother to explain the individual terms here, but by using this expression, you can determine the enhancement factor that's given here. So where epsilon omega is the complex frequency dependent dielectric function of the metal, epsilon naught is an dielectric constant of the bulk medium, and d is the distance of the molecule from the surface. And the sub, whatever the index you see, inc, it's for the incident, and sv for the scattered. So large SERS enhancement is obtained if at wavelengths of the incident radiation, incident or scattered radiation, the real part of the dielectric function is close to -2 epsilon naught, and the imaginary part of epsilon naught is very, very small. Because the dielectric function, you know, it's not a, it has got the real part as well as the imaginary part. It's a complex function. And if this condition is getting satisfied where the real part is close to -2 epsilon naught, epsilon naught is the dielectric medium of the bulk, and the imaginary part is very, very small, then we can expect large enhancement factors. This factor also tells us how to choose the factor, because you might have read different papers where they use gold as a substrate or silver as a substrate. Likewise, so like experimentalists can hit and try on a trial basis, they can select a good substrate. But the theoretical background for that is given by this relationship of the dielectric of the dielectric function here plays a major role. So that has said, the silver and gold and silver are the common substrates or substrate. Silver is used in a broad excitation range, all the way from 400 to 1200 nanometer, whereas gold is used, works effectively in 600 to 1200. Nanometer. Copper and lithium are reactive metals, but they can serve as noble substrates. Okay? Although many people do not use copper for a simple reason, that copper can get oxidized easily to copper oxide, and that will affect the dielectric function of the lithium. But then I will also show you that how in my own group we also use copper. Other metals are like platinum, ruthenium, rhodium, etc. are applicable, but then the excitation of the incoming radiation has to be in the ultraviolet range. And their enhancement factor also seem to be very, very relatively lesser. Third important factor is that the molecule, it need not be in direct contact. And in chemistry, what we mean by direct contact is actually making a chemical bond. All that it means is that it could also be physisorbed or it could be chemisorbed. Chemisorbed is direct contact. Even in physisorbed, you can expect. But then it's a very, very long range, it's a very short range effect, so much so that the source enhancement thing reduces or decreases in the order of 1 by d power 12, where d stands for the separation between the substrate and the adsorbent and the adsorbate. Okay, so you can see such a short range effect it is. The chemical mechanism of it, as I already told you, I will skip it. It's just to do that the molecule is chemisorbed on the adsorbate, and because of which the molecular polarizability tensor of the system gets completely altered, and then there is change in the homolumo level, the Fermi level of the metal. Transfer of electron happens from the Fermi level of the metal to the lowest to LUMO level of the molecule, and that is made possible only through a chemical bond forming between the adsorbent and the adsorbate. I'll skip this part. The chemical mechanism is unable to explain large enhancements. Okay, and it is only the electromagnetic mechanism which explains large enhancements. Now, these are two mechanisms. Okay, so in reality, what is happening? It's not like binary. That is, not, we do not know. It may be convoluted. That may happen there. That's why the distinction between EM and chemical mechanism is complicated. The existence of charge transfer mechanism can be experimentally proved by measurement of excitation profiles. In other words, the dependence of source spectra on excitation wavelength. That is, you keep changing the excitation wavelength and you observe the change in the intensity of the source peaks, and thereby we can say the charge transfer has happened or not. If charge transfer is happening, that will tell you that is the chemical mechanism is what is playing major role there. This is about the enhancement factors. As I said, that I was asked that I should spend a little more time on explaining how the enhancement factor is calculated in the source spectrum. As I said in the beginning, there are different strategies employed to measure the enhancement factor. One such I am summarizing here. One I will tell from my own research group, and one I will tell it in very brief passing. So enhancement factor is given by this normalized source intensities. Normalization happens in the sense that if I get a source peak, I divide that source peak intensity by the number of scatterers, number of source scatterers. And that thing will be divided by the same peak, but not under source, but by using Raman spectroscopy and the number of Raman scatterers. So this overall fraction is going to determine us, or is going to determine the enhancement factor. We replace a number with, say, a concentration. That is what referred to as the analytical enhancement factor. And these two are not much different. It's only terminology variations where you use the number of scatterers in the previous and the concentration in the latter. The electromagnetic, the enhancement factor strongly depends on the properties, namely the properties of the metallic substrate and analyte. That's very obvious. And obviously, it also depends on the excitation wavelength. And now, the standardization is not actually possible. Rather, I would rephrase it this way. Standardization of enhancement factor is non-trivial. It's rather complicated because of the different factors that involve that affect the enhancement factor. So silver provides higher enhancement factor than gold in the region 400 to 600. And above 600, gold becomes comparable to silver and can deliver maximum enhancement factor of the order 10 to the power 10 to even 10 to the power 11. Once again, what is not captured here, in the case of electromagnetic mechanism also, it also depends upon the orientation or the way the absorption is taking place on the metal substrate. If the morphology of the substrate is different, the adsorption will be different. The orientation of the adsorption. So there are many factors which will affect the enhancement factor. This is from one example. taken from a fairly recent paper where they look at the mercaptopyridine adsorbed on silver film. And this is an interesting paper where they have detailed out this mechanism of calculating the enhancement factor as the method I had described to you in the previous slide. So this is an example of that. Those of you interested can have a look at this paper to calculate the, to know about the enhancement factor, how it is calculated, by just using the same method that I have described before. Same fraction is repeated here. Now here you may have a question that when the molecule is, say, measured under Raman spectra, it will show some peaks. Now, will those same peaks be exactly same when I'm observing them under SERS? Obviously, we cannot say a priori whether it will be same or different. If it is a physics option, you can expect it to be same, but even then, because there is a physics option happening, there could be shifts happening, and not just shift. Shift is to do with the x-axis change. There could be, obviously, there is intensity change where there is an enhancement that is happening. So, as a thumb rule, you cannot say whether the SERS peak will be exactly identical to the Raman peak or not. Most, that is something which one has to work out and see. So, this is an example of that paper. Very briefly, they have compared, they have made the mercaptopyridine adsorb on silver coated on a prism, and they have measured the enhancement factor. Once you have this, and then you have silver, they do not have a silver, just you have the pyridine coated on the prism and measure the enhancement factor. That's a very elegant way to measure the enhancement factor here. Okay, I will. As I said, applications of SERS are very wide. Single molecule detection, bio in medicines, you can in flow cytometry, quantitative detection of biomolecular interaction is rendered possible. Many applications are there, but since time is not there, I'll quickly say what we do in our group. It's the instrumentation part. I'll skip the details. This I need to mention. This is from my collaborator, Dr. Suresh. He's an electrochemist. So what he does is he kind of makes a novel electrodes for his electrochemistry experiment. And what those novel electrodes are, he takes pencil graphite, and on the pencil graphite, he deposits different metals electrochemically. And he uses, and he does electrochemistry for his own research. So we thought that why not we use this graphite coated with metal as a SERS substrate. And we started looking at copper. So this is nothing but having copper nanostructures on pencil graphite. So cost-wise, this is extremely cheap and very effective also. So this is what is referred to as sample preparation. It typically happens again by through electrochemistry here. Now you have pencil graphite on which the metal is coated, and on that we'll have to coat the analyte that we require to study. That is done through, and that is observed whether the coating has happened or not, is observed through cyclic voltammetry. One such example I will give you with, so using para-aminothiophenol. So here I should tell you what is CuPG. Cu, copper coated on pencil graphite, and copper coated on a core shell, a copper silver core shell kind of a nano structure coated on pencil graphite. So this was about this molecule, the para-aminothiophenol. It was reported in 2010 in JAX as well as in PCCP by the same group later in 2012, that silver, when it is adsorbed on silver, this amine group actually forms a NN double bond gets formed. And they showed that this is a photocatalytic reaction that happens. So what we did was we tried to repeat or reproduce the same reaction, not using silver, but using copper, and that too copper coated on a pencil graphite. So this is how the conformation happens, that black is your uncoated, before the monolayer formation, monolayer of para-aminothiophenol. Red is the cyclic voltammogram, or cyclic volta, CV of the copper, CV of PATB coated on the copper coated on pencil graphite. In other words, this tells us that the monolayer has formed. In other words, the molecule paraminothiophenol has got adsorbed on the copper nanostructure. And for comparison's sake here, we have also carried out using bulk copper. So I will quickly show you. This is the spectrum, normal Raman spectrum of paraminothiophenol, where you can quickly take register this peaks at 1090. Hello?
You are audible, sir?
Yeah. I was getting some noise. I was thinking somebody is trying to talk to me. Keep in mind about the peak at 1090, 1596 and 1171. Now the interesting chemistry happens at this region. I mean, here first let me explain. Okay, so Raman spectrum of ethanol A and Raman spectrum of 100 millimolar of paraminothiophenol in ethanol. If you can see here, spectra A and B are in fact identical. There is no visible change except for, you know, little bit this spectra looks more noisy compared to the black spectra. What it means is that even a concentration as high as 100 millimolar of paraminothiophenol in ethanol is not showing Raman spectra of paraminothiophenol. The response that you see in the red is exactly like the response we see for pure ethanol. Okay. Whereas, if we look at the surge spectra of even 1 micromolar of paraminothiophenol, then we see that is a blue spectra here. Okay. We see the spectrum is also slightly very different. Spectrum is very different, and you look at the concentration change from 100 millimolar, what was not observed, now we go to 1 micromolar. So straight away, you can see that the enhancement factor of 10 to the power 6, the enhancement factor you can see. I mean, this is a minimum you can expect, because how the experiment is done in for the normal Raman spectra, the number of molecules that are in the focal cone of the incoming radiation, those are all giving you the Raman scattering. That will be much, much more than the number of photons, number of molecules that are there on the, again on the focal cone, but now they're adsorbed on the copper surface. So that's why I'm saying the lower limit of the enhancement factor, I'm quoting it as 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 6. Okay. Rather, in fact, it is straight away 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 8 rather, because it is 100 millimolar to 1 micromolar. So this, at this juncture, I would like to say that this is also another way by which, if all other conditions are same, namely the laser power intensity is the same, the time that you normally take to integrate your spectra, that is amount of time the laser is on the shining on the medium, if every other factor is same, okay, if only this concentration is changing and you're seeing this spectra, that also can, you can calculate, roughly estimate the enhancement factor here. But this way of estimating, I already told you the drawback, we cannot precisely get it because the number of molecules are going to be different. But otherwise, what we're quoting as enhancement factor is a lower bound at least. So this is about the chemistry that is happening. I'm not interested to show you the chemistry part. This is an enhancement factor of this is 10 to the power 5 or 10 to the power even 8 we can get into. And this is another molecule, 4-mercaptobenzoic acid, where I will not show you the details. Similarly, you can see here Raman spectrum of ethanol and Raman spectrum of 10 millimolar of 4 MPa. You can see that the two spectra are more or less identical, not much of a difference. Whereas the same 1 millimolar of 4-mercaptobenzoic acid on copper bulk and 1 millimolar of 4-mercaptobenzoic acid on copper PG. So here you can see that there is an enhancement factor of at least we can look at how the low detection limit is determined here. At least 10 to 100 times the enhancement factor is seen in this case. Similarly, this is another example of amino acid cysteine. An interesting thing happens here. I will not bother. This is not about enhancement factor. I'll keep this short. This is about silver nanoparticles and detection of glutathione. That you can, this glutathione detection has got its own importance in multiple fields. I'll skip the details here, rather quickly show you the enhancement factor. So you can see here, but I can also say the black spectrum is your Raman spectrum of your glutathione. And particularly here, 2532 centimeter inverse corresponds to the SH single bond appears somewhere here. The red spectrum, if you see, that is red is at glutathione adsorbed on silver surface, silver nanoparticles. And this peak is actually vanished, which means that the adsorption has happened clearly using this SH peak, SH functional group, and obviously sulfur will have more affinity for towards the sulfur, towards the silver. It's more like a chemisorption that has happened here. That's why the SH peak has completely got vanished. About the enhancement factor, the blue spectrum is 10 millimolar of glutathione in water. And similarly, you can see that the 10 millimolar of glutathione in Raman spectrum of 10 millimolar of glutathione is in the red spectrum. And this somewhat yellowish, orangish yellow spectrum is 100 nanomolars of GSH. So you can clearly see that you can have a enhancement factor minimum of also at least 10 to the power 5. So I showed you, I mean, this I will not bother about, this is about the concluding part of my work here. So with that, I close. What I've shown you is the basic theory of the surface enhanced Raman scattering. And I showed you two different ways by which you can calculate the enhancement factor. The third one, which I said I'll mention it by passing, is that you keep everything, all the conditions same. Okay. Even the concentration you keep same. Now you keep playing with the laser intensity. By changing the laser intensity, if you're able to see the source peak, that also you can determine the enhancement factor. And other way is to the integration time, depending upon what kind of instrument you are using. The amount of time the laser beam is exposed on the sample, based on keeping in mind that every other factor is constant. Okay, then also we can measure the enhancement factor. So with that, I come to the conclusion. I thank the DST and particularly two of my students, Aarti, whose results I had presented, and Poonam, who helped me prepare this presentation. And I thank you all for your patient listening, even though I had some technical glitches, both at the beginning as well as in the middle. I'll be happy to answer your questions. If I know the answers, I'll be able to answer them immediately. Otherwise, I will have to seek your excuse and I will get back to you perhaps through the organizer later. So if you have any questions, you can.
Yes, thank you so much, sir. And we congratulate you on a very informative session. So we have a few questions in the chat box. So the question is from Deepak Kumar. So he would like to know that what is the main motivation to go from Raman to surface enhanced Raman technique? So any highlights on this, sir?
Right. The audio was interrupted. Can you please repeat the question?
Okay. So the question is from Deepak. So he's asking that could you please highlight the main motivation to go from Raman to surface enhanced Raman technique?
Yeah, the motivation is simple because Raman is a very weak phenomenon, and you needed enhancement factors. And I showed you at least that you could have enhancement of 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 8. Okay. So that is the motivation factor, nothing else.
Okay. So thank you so much, sir. The next question is from Deepak again. So he's asking that, is there any new update other than surface enhanced Raman technique available or in progress that you would like?
If I understand the question, what you're asking is, are there different avatars of Raman which are bringing about enhancement? Of course, yes. You
Yes.
have lots and lots of modifications using nonlinear optical methods like CARS, coherent anti-Stokes Raman scattering, stimulated Raman scattering. Then you have very lots of modifications, near field microscopes. This you can, I mean, there are a number of modifications. These are few names that comes to my mind immediately. These are all there where the Raman and the Raman signals are enhanced by different orders of magnitude. And some of these techniques, I'm sure, C.V. Raman also could not have anticipated, because of technological advancements, both in the laser side as well as in the detector side, many such avatars are possible. So yes, they are there. Next question.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening.
Yes, thank you so much, sir, for this informative session. Sir, I'm Prachi and I'm working with Dr. Pooja ma'am on this technique itself. So I have a couple of questions for you.
Yeah.
As you mentioned that the laser which has been used for silver nanoparticles, or the results with which silver nanoparticles and gold nanoparticles give best results is 600, above 600 for gold and like below that for silver. But
yes.
In some studies that I have read, I came across that for gold also people have used the lasers below 600 nanometers, and for silver as well, sometimes lasers have been used above that range, like near 785
yes.
or somewhat like that. So, so my question is that how we can choose the best laser for our material? Like if please speak.
I got your point. See, investment
yes.
in a laser is a huge investment.
Yes,
I mean,
sir.
There are some labs in our country which have got lasers of all wavelengths, starting from, you know, very low wavelength, like they may have green 532, they will have 355 or 255. So investment in laser is a huge investment. Now, the papers that you have studied where they might have used gold even with 400 nanometer is that their lab might have had that laser and they would have chosen gold for some reason. So it is not that the gold will not respond at all. Ideal condition for it to have maximum efficiency is gold when you use it for lasers with incident laser more than 600. That's what it means. But then many times we are tied up with what constraints, with what kind of things we have it in our disposal. Like this copper work, I did not have silver and gold nanoparticle with me. I had to work with, so what I'm trying to say is, there is the rule of thumb is there, but then if our facility in the lab permits us to go by the rule of thumb, well and good. If not, as experimentalist, as a spirit of experiment, we will have to do it and see if it suits us. Well and good, we can use that. So I would not advise any gold rule of thumb like you should use this or you should use that. As I said, it depends upon the dielectric function. It also depends upon the vibrational frequency of the molecule which is getting adsorbed on the gold or the silver surface. There are examples where some molecules for the same wavelength of light respond, give much more enhancement with gold or not much more enhancement with silver, because it is plasmon is just one part which is to do with the laser and the metal substrate. The other part is also equally important, the kind of molecule which is getting adsorbed on. I'm sure I have not given you a satisfactory answer, but this is the best answer that I can think of as of now.
Okay, thank you, sir. So my another question is that, as you said that the role of laser is there and the dielectric constant, can you please throw some more light on the dielectric constant role in the source?
Qualitatively, I can say
yes.
that how the ultimately the plasmons have to get excited. The extent to which the plasmon can get excited will depend upon the dielectric function of the medium. See, actually, if you see, this is related also to the photoelectric effect. There we call it as a work function. We may use different terminology in different context. What do we say there? there the energies, the photoelectric effect, what do we say? The incoming radiation is kicking out the electron. It's polarizing it so much that it is coming out of the bound of the core electrons there, cores of the metal thing there. Slightly lesser comes is the effect. The effect happening is the same, but then qualitatively what I'm trying to say is the incoming radiation should be able to excite the plasmons on the metal substrate, not excited to the extent that they will be kicked off as it is in photoelectric effect, or it will not so less that it will not couple with the molecule. So that is where there are some papers which talk about, you know, I can share this PowerPoint, which has got very interesting papers reference. I have not shown you here, but what I will do is after this talk, I will share this PowerPoint with Dr. Pooja. There in some papers, they have given the dielectric function of the different metal substrate and under what wavelength of light, incoming radiation, for certain molecules, what enhancement factor you can observe. And that will be more helpful. So qualitatively, this is the answer that I can give, that the surface plasmon has to get excited with the incoming radiation.
Okay. Sir, my next question is related to slide number 34, where you have shown a comparative graph of source enhancement. Yes, sir. Here, GSH in water and ethanol.
Yeah.
So here that this black spectrum that you have shown and the red spectrum, the intensity here, black spectrum is having more intensity and the SIR spectra is the red one. So actually,
it's a very good question.
Yes, sir.
But the answer is also in the slide. What you have looked at is only these two spectra. But I'm happy you had a very keen observation. And but I'm saying you that the answer is also in these two lines. Can you make out what is the answer?
Sir, it's like first one is the powder which has been used.
Yes.
And another one is in the water.
That to 10 millimolar.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is not for comparing enhancement factor here.
Okay, sir.
This is just to tell you that the adsorption is happening. This is just to tell you the disappearance of this. The purpose of showing this data is to impress upon you or impress upon the audience that look, in this SIRS experiment, this molecule is getting chemisorbed on the silver, on the nanomaterial. It is only for that purpose. It is not for enhancement. Showing the enhancement purpose. No. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Sir, one question actually related kind of this I want to ask that when we are plotting results for SIRS and we are comparing the peak enhancements. So sometimes it happens that not every peak is enhanced or not every peak is enhanced in the same ratio as other peaks are enhanced.
Obviously, that I mentioned in my talk also. Yes.
Yes, sir.
But you cannot expect all the bonds to get experience the same enhancement factor. It's
yes,
very
sir.
Obvious.
Sir, but sometimes when we are presenting our results, how we can relate it to enhancement or how we can justify the enhancement if all the peaks are not there in results. For example, in certain cases,
I got your point. Let me answer that. Answer is also there in this slide. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now tell me, look at this black and red spectra.
Yes, sir.
Actually speaking, I made one comment also when I was giving the presentation a few minutes back that you would expect the Raman and the SIR spectra to be more or less similar, except for changes in the intensity. I'm saying that also you cannot expect in many cases. There will be a lot of shifts. For instance, this set of peaks that you see in the black spectrum here, you don't see them in the red spectrum at all. Although there's a big bump here.
Yes, sir.
But what I'm trying to say is that the spectra is not identical.
Okay.
So under such circumstances, how can you attribute the enhancement factor? Peak by peak enhancement, how can you report? That's your question actually.
Yes, sir.
You will have to employ a different strategy to report the enhancement factor. Strategy that I have employed here is to tell you that, look, I take 10 millimolar of glutathione in water and I am seeing the peaks of glutathione because my black spectra is just the silver nanoparticle dispersed in water. Yes. So between the black and the blue spectra, what is the difference? It's only that the glutathione is absorbed on the silver nanoparticle. So for sure, I know the black spectra does not give any response. Black is like a baseline. If you can see the black line here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now I say that my 10 millimolar look is giving me this response. Okay. Now under the same condition, my red spectra Raman of 10 millimolar of glutathione is not giving any response. It's like no vibrational peak at all. Whereas with my SIRS, I can go down to as low as 100 nanomolar because this yellow spectra and the blue spectra, the profile is more or less reproducible throughout. Can you see that?
Yes, sir.
So here, that's how I can say my enhancement is 10 to the power 5.
Okay.
You get the point. That's why I'm saying it is, you cannot adopt one strategy to report the enhancement factor. Or you can go back to this paper where they have done this mercaptopyridine. They had absorbed the mercaptopyridine on the prism. So you do it that way. You first have it absorbed and not have it absorbed and then thereby measure the enhancement factor. So the summary, what the take home message that I'm trying to give is, there is no one standard way to report the enhancement factor. Whatever your experiment permits, there accordingly you'll have to see. Say, this is also a good example. 1578 peak, I'm not able to see, I'm not seeing it in the B spectra at all.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so how can I say this peak is getting enhanced or not? Rather, here, if you read the paper, the B is the Raman spectra and A must be the SIRS spectra. Okay, so whatever you see is a tiny peak here that is getting enhanced here. It's 992 is getting shifted to 1012. Right? So the take home message here is there is no one method by which you can report the enhancement factor. So when you have different peaks are getting enhanced differently. You will have to see what is it that you are interested to report. Are you looking at it from the molecular point of view or you're looking at it from the substrate point of view? You're going to say, fine, now this kind of the gold nanostructure is a better substrate. So you can report a range of enhancement using this gold substrate and using standard molecules like pyridine or, you know, some kind of thio molecule. I hope that answered your question.
Yes. So my last question is that I came across a statement somewhere that methanol is doesn't show SIRS enhancement. So can you please tell me something about that. Why is it so? Because I cannot come across a satisfactory answer for that.
Methanol, we have also worked on methanol.
Yes, sir.
And it is challenging to see. Ethanol definitely shows SIRS enhancement factor. And we have seen that for ethanol ourselves. But for methanol, yes, we also have experienced problem in observing it. The reason of it, I'm sorry, I'm not able to, I do not have a correct reason in my head right now. Maybe I'll look it up and I can get back to you. I also do not have, the reason is not ready at the top of my head.
Okay.
It's got to do with the methoxy stability of that, it forms a methoxy radical. Because in the ethane case, that's what the reason comes. But I'm sorry, I don't want to confuse you with a very sloppy reason for that. I'll have to go through and come back to you.
Okay, sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your time. That's all from my side. Thank you so much.
Okay, yep.
Yes, sir. So we have a few questions in the chat box. So if you permit, shall we take them?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So the question is from Sangeeta. So she wanted to know that Is it possible to detect defects on the surface using SIRS?
Is it possible to what?
To detect surface defects using SIRS.
Surface defects using SIRS.
With something SIRS. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can design an experiment where, you know, if the adsorbing molecule responds differently when it is adsorbed on a defect region and when it is adsorbed on a non-defect region, if it has different SIRS response, in principle, yes, you can detect it. But I cannot guarantee you that you will be definitely able to detect, because one has to do it and see. But that under this condition that the SIRS response is different, or the extent of adsorption is different in a defect region and a non-defect region, based on that, you can design an experiment and check it out.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. So the next question is from Sandeep. So he wanted to know could you please comment on the stability of gold or silver based solid substrates by using SIRS?
By stability, understanding you're referring to gold or silver nanoparticles. Right?
Probably, yes, sir, because the...
Yeah, otherwise yeah. It's metals. And in the context of SERS, you are referring to gold and silver nanoparticles. Here, the stability means that you would not like the particles to aggregate, form aggregates. So you will have to use appropriate, maybe stabilizers. Over the time, if the particles are going to aggregate, that may affect the adsorption. So obviously, when you will be using these nanoparticles, you will be using them with stabilizers. More than that, I'm not sure what is the meaning of stability here. Look at copper, the ball game is slightly different. Copper, the stability has to do with the reaction, because we do not, we perform it in the open air. So the copper nanoparticles with its increased surface area, if it is getting converted to say copper oxide, then silver without the stabilizer is also, but then the silver oxide formation is much slower compared to copper. So you can talk of stability in terms of chemical stability also. Next.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So the next question, sir, I have one question for you. Okay. So the question is, sir, I've read in papers that often, you know, the importance of surface wettability on SIRS based ultra sensitive detection of analytes is often observed. Like many super, you know, hydrophobic substrates are not good for SIRS. So, sir, could you comment on it? Like, does this surface wettability also affect?
I frankly have not thought or worked in that line. So,
okay.
I'm sorry. Again, I have to say, I do not have a ready answer for that.
Okay, sir. No issues, sir. Thank you. So, there are no more questions in the chat box. So, I request participants, if they have any more questions, so we can take up them. Otherwise, we shall like to thank the speaker. If no more questions from the participants.
Hello.
Yes, Rishabh.
Yeah. Somebody has. Please go.
Hello.
Yes, Abhradeep Das, you have any questions?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, sir, please go ahead.
Hello.
Bolo.
Yeah, sir, I would like to ask that I am using like graphene reinforced austenitic stainless steel. In that case, I am doing a Raman spectroscopy to get the D and 2D and G peaks so that I can ensure that there will be a presence of graphene in the in my composite that
you
I can
lost the audio. Abhradeep, I lost your audio in the middle. You are using graphene reinforced steel, and then, sir, what you are doing, Raman spectra to detect the 2D and the 2G,
to detect the presence of graphene on my material. Is it possible that by using SIRS I can detect the position where there will be graphene agglomerates or the presence of graphene is like imminent in that particular region. Can I do using that search?
See, you use the word, can I know the position? When you are interested to know the position, actually you need to look at the microscopy. So there are SIRS based, tip enhanced, it's called TERS. That's another avatar of it. Tip enhanced Raman scattering. So, AFM has got a particular tip. Like that, what happens is you come with a metallic tip and then you probe the molecule. If you're interested in knowing the position, yes, it can be known, but then simple SIRS spectra will not be enough. For that, you need to go to a microscopy based experiment.
Yes, sir. Actually, the purpose is that I have a disc containing a graphene reinforced composite. Okay, so the following disc contains graphene, that is ensured, but I want to detect the presence of graphene in a microscopy like TEM. Okay, hello,
I got your point. That's what, so
kindly, I mean, like, I need to find the
question. Complete your question. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I want to use TEM to visualize the graphene. Hello. Presence
audio.
Of graphene. Okay.
Hello. Please complete your question.
Yes, sir. I would like to use TEM to detect the position, to detect graphene, okay, on my composite, on the surface, microstructure of my composite. But to ensure that whether the following position contains graphene before microscopy, can I use SIRS to determine that, to detect that position? Because from my disc, I need to take out punch of 3 mm diameter for the TEM purpose. And what if I punch out the 3 mm disc from that position where there will be no graphene agglomerates present in that powder? So, is it possible, like using Raman spectroscopy, I determine that position where graphene is, it is ensured that there will be a graphene?
I part of the question I have answered already, but let me try to answer you in a slightly different way. Okay.
Okay.
For that also, to know that which region of yours contains this graphene, because for that will help you for you that will help you to punch out the correct region for your TEM.
Exactly.
Simple surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy, you will have to perhaps do it maybe at different spots. What do I mean by different spot? I'm trying to open my Microsoft Paint here. If I can open that, I can perhaps draw it and show it to you.
Yeah,
just give that me one minute. Are you able to see my paint window?
No, sir. Yes, sir. Now I can see.
Okay. So now this is your disc where you are using your graphene reinforced microstructures of the steel.
Yes, sir. The disc is additively manufactured powder based graphene reinforced.
Now, you are saying that the graphene is distributed like this, imagine.
Yeah.
Right? This is your problem. Now, you are worried that before you take to TEM, you should not punch out this region.
Exactly, sir.
You want to punch out only this region.
That region where graphene is present. So that
That's
I can...
So the star, let's understand it this way. The star regions are the graphene regions.
Exactly, sir.
And the rectangles are the region where you are punching. So, before giving it to TEM, you want to make sure that you are not here, rather you are here.
Yes, sir.
That you want to make sure using surface enhanced Raman scattering. And my answer is yes, you can do it. But then, that's also tricky. Why tricky? Because in the Raman spectra, if you have a look, you will have actually a lens. you actually have a lens which is going to condense your incoming radiation. Say the radiation is coming from the top, okay? This is a laser radiation which is coming from the top. This is going to focus your beam here. I'll magnify this portion. Sorry. Let me magnify this portion and I will show you how this looks. This actually looks like, I need a free pen to draw. So this region will look like this when I blow it up. And okay, this diameter that you get,
yes sir,
is roughly lambda by, you can, that's a diffraction limit also, that is roughly lambda by 2.
Okay.
So now I'm using 532 nanometer of laser. Say I'm using. So I will have this distance in the order of 260 nanometer.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you may shine the laser here, or let's first look at this diameter here. If it is not in the focus, it is 260 nanometer. Say if it's in the focus, it is going to be say 400 nanometer. I'm just taking a very rough limit. Okay. Now, if you are lucky enough, say your graphite region is the spread is say something like how much? Say 1 millimeter or half a millimeter. That's quite huge, right? You are now trying to probe something which is half a millimeter wide using 400 nanometer stuff. What you'll have to do, you'll have to systematically do the experiment by which you can take the spectra from different regions.
Is it like
maybe sometimes?
Is it
somebody was saying something?
Surface with that laser. Yes, sir. Hello.
Yeah, if your instrument allows you to scan well and good, you scan it. Otherwise, physically you'll have to take spectra from each and every point. But then there again you will have a problem. After you have taken it, okay, you will come to know fine. It is like, you know, it's like a searching needle in the haystack. That's the problem here. Principle. Haystack, but doing it is going to be a little cumbersome. On the other hand, if you have a microscope, there the XY information is also getting saved along with the spectral data. It is easy to go back to the XY region. Does it answer your question, or did I confuse you?
So the last section I am not able to understand. Like you have said, like I understand that there will be different regions. If I scan, I take various Raman spectroscopy of various points, there will be difference in the shift in the peaks. That will be very much evident, right? There will be variation in peaks, but does it guarantee anywhere that this position
I
is
lost
like,
your voice again.
Hello.
Yeah, Pradeep, I am not able to hear you.
Yes, sir. What I am saying that the particular region that I am locating, getting the shift of peaks, does it guarantee that these positions have, this will guarantee that these positions have different in graphene concentration?
If there is, okay, that's what I'm trying to explain to you. Let's look at this. You imagine you are taking a spectra along this line. Okay. So you will this imagine there are 100 spectra across this line you have taken. And in those 100 spectra, all that you will get is 20 spectra may give you a shift.
Yes, sir.
This line somewhere, I have my graphene. That's all you can say, but you cannot pinpointedly say, okay, fine, it is only in this region. You're trying to understand what I'm trying to say.
Yes, sir. I understand.
Okay, so that's why again and again I'm saying you need a microscope where when you scan this, okay, this is spectra number one, and this will have a matrix, and it will have like a matrix label. Okay, say this is position number, say A31, then A32, A34, A35, A36, A37. And you will say that, okay, fine, from A37 to A320, all these spectra are looking different. And then in your lab, the way you have mounted it, you can have some external label or marker saying, fine, this is oriented in such a way, or you can put a dot somewhere in this and saying that this is exactly in the south direction, this is in the north direction. You can play around and you can still, you can then you can pinpoint it. But by using simple Raman spectra, you cannot do that.
Okay, sir. And that another question, another basic question that I am going to ask is that the utility of SIR, I mean, like normal Raman spectroscopy gives me something like the peaks of graphene or organic molecules. In case of SIR, is it just the modification? The only modification is that it is getting enhanced by 10 to the power in the order of 10 to the power 6 or 7, right? Nothing
yes.
Of difference.
Yes. That whatever you have used as just enhancement, that is very remarkable, because now I can look at proteins which are a very, very low concentration. So that it's yes, it is just 10 to the power 6 enhancement, but that just 10 to the power 6 enhancement is a big, big issue. It's a big thing.
Yeah.
Okay. That's where the utility comes much, much more.
Yeah. That will increase the resolution, obviously. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you really very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, you're welcome.
Yes, thank you, sir. So now I would like to invite Dr. Pooja for her final comments for the session.
There is one last more question from Dr. Pooja itself. It's in the chat box. Are all organic molecules are Raman active?
No. Raman activity is governed by, again, selection rules, that the polarizability should change, right? Now, simple answer is no, not all molecules will be Raman active.
Okay, sir.
Then the question will come, how do you decide which molecule is going to be active? Now, there are theoretical ways, you know, by looking at the vibrational mode, which of them will be active. There are theoretical ways possible, but from an experimentalist point of view to select the molecule, I would say we are lucky that whichever molecule has got more of functional groups, where the polarizability with electron delocalization is easier, there you can expect it to have the Raman activity. I'll put it that way.
So in the absence of functional groups, there might be a possibility we get a Raman inactive.
In the absence of functional group, it is less possible that it may be Raman active.
Okay. So there is one more question from my side. Sometimes in our lab, we observe a peak at 1122 specifically. So it was observed basically in many of the samples, but it is not from the samples itself. We asked, you know, the operator as well as the engineer of the instrument. So he said it is due to an error. So he said to he recommended for the peak removal. So have you faced any such problems?
These are common problems where sometimes the detector gets, you know, sometimes the detector gets scratched somewhere. So you will always see an anomalous peak in the spectrum. Sometimes what happens, there is a leak. So if you're using a tube light source, the mercury peaks will start coming. Basically, the tube lights, the mercury vapors are used. And in the room, if the detector is not well enclosed, that spectrometer, there is some leak of the ambient light, you will see that also appearing. So I have faith. These are very common problems when you deal with spectroscopy.
Okay. Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful
talk. But I thought you were interested to know how you remove it. Or
Yeah,
if
sir.
some if, or if your molecule has also got a vibrational response at say 1122, then
Yeah,
you are in a big soup. Then you are
yes,
in a
sir.
problem.
Then how to differentiate between the
Then
two?
you cannot differentiate actually. If there is an intrinsic error, intrinsic peak coming, and your molecule also has got a response in that region, then it is actually a problem. It's you are in a problem. You cannot solve that. You have to change the system.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Anupma, you can take over.
Yes, thank you so much,
Yeah,
sir.
for sure.
So now I would like to request Dr. Pooja for the final comments.
Can I
Please ask.
presentation, like some of the results I was seeing that you mentioned that this enhancement factor, it can be taken with reference to the Raman signal.
Yeah.
But Raman setting, you may not get peak that concentration, while in SARS, you may get peak. So how
Yes.
that ratio is taken?
How that? How that?
With what concentration you compare? Like, it's not necessary that in Raman, say, 10 to power, say, minus 5 molar, you may not get any Raman peak, but you may get a peak in SARS.
That's
So in the
okay.
absolute,
I got your
I
point. I got your question.
practically, huh?
That's what I wanted to show you using that experiment, that example. Some of this sharing menu is not activated in my end. It is now it is showing, yes. So what we do is that okay, fine. I have a concentration, say as much as whatever soluble in the water. Take for example this itself. So here I have 100 millimolar of diaminothiaphenol, and say this is having solubility, and no solubility issue is coming with the, say this is saturated or forget. For the Raman spectrum, I see that I don't see any response, the spectrum B. Now your question is, how do I decide if I'm getting SARS peaks? That's your precise question, right? Now what we do
Yeah,
is,
my
okay, fine.
suggestion here is like for the B, you're not getting any peak, say, at 1500, like significant peak at 1500. But for C, even for 1 micron, you have significant peak. So
Yes.
when you take enhancement factor and calculation in picture, so now your concentration is different. So you put these concentration, or you take those concentration where you are getting some Raman signal. Like you will compare 100 millimolar with 1 micromolar.
Yes, that's what I'm trying to say. So here I get a one, I will try first 100 millimolar in the SARS. Then what I do, I gradually decrease from 100 to I come to say 10. Then I come to 1 millimolar. Then 100 micromolar. So I see what is my lowest concentration in SARS. I'm able to see the scatters. Suppose I go to say lower than 1 micromolar, say 100 nanomolar. For this system, 100 nanomolar will not give me any response. So there I conclude saying, fine, 1 micromolar is my limit with which in my system I can detect the scatter in the SARS, using the SARS method. So whatever highest concentration I could not detect in normal Raman, whatever lowest I could detect using SERS, I use that to calculate the enhancement factor.
Okay, and like in graph C, your signature peak at A and B, they are diminished. So what is the reason behind that?
By signature peak, you are referring to these peaks, right?
Signal peaks, yeah.
3000 wave number.
Yes. Are they were all?
They are not there at all. So that's what I'm saying. The mode of adsorption is very different. So you cannot expect uniform enhancement. Perhaps here this molecule, this peak here in the near 3000, it all corresponds to CH stretch. So it may so happen that this, along with the sulfur, this entire benzene ring is also getting adsorbed on the silver nanoparticle. That's why I'm not seeing any CH peak here. Right? So the mode of adsorption has to be first determined properly. And as I, this is again, it's like enhancement will not be same at all. So this other example will be more clearer to impress upon you the enhancement factor thing with the glutathione thing. Yeah. So here, if you also see, that's what I said. Now, black spectrum here is only water and silver nanoparticle. The red spectrum is the highest concentration, whatever solubility permits, that also is not giving any response with normal Raman. But the yellow spectrum is the lowest limit with which I can detect it using the SERS. So that's how I compare the, I use the concentration difference as my enhancement factor, even though the signature peaks comparison will not be possible. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
So now I would like to thank you for this informative session. I can see this session has gone for around approximately 2 hours, and a lot of questions are coming from the audience. And you explained the things very nicely, very clearly, and happy to see the wonderful work being done by your group. We may look for some collaborative work in future. So I would like to thank IEEE and TC for organizing this program, and Anupa for moderating it very nicely. So thank you again. Thank you all the participants joining the session. Thank you, Ram.
Yes, thank you so much, ma'am, for chairing the session. So, sir, as a token of recognition and appreciation, so we present you the certificate of appreciation from our IEEE student branch. So we would like to thank you on behalf of the complete IEEE team. So thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful deliberation at our platform. And we look forward for more wonderful sessions from your side. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. And it was, I see that a very long discussion after the talk, almost for 15 minutes. Looks like people are interested in this talk. Okay, I'm also good. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
So I request all the participants and sir to turn on their video. We can have a group picture. So I request all the participants. And Dr. Pooja ma'am, if possible, please turn on your videos. We can have a group picture. Prachi, Aditi ma'am, all IEEE members, please. And I'm happy to share, we had many international participants also. So I would like to thank all of them. In spite of different time zones, they have made it possible to join our session. So thank you everyone joining us from Philippines, Egypt, US, and from Malaysia and many other countries. So thank you everyone.